An ongoing study on the local impact of climate change focuses on unexpected effects, like the proliferation of disease-carrying insects. But as my guest Stanley Maloy, microbiology professor and dean of SDSU's College of Sciences, explains, our warming world has both scientific and ethical implications. Stanley, thanks so much for joining us. Let's start with the science. A report by World Bank recently found that the Earth will be about 4 degrees hotter by the end of the century. Walk us through how these single-digit temperature changes are actually linked or could change infectious disease transmission.
So 4 degrees is by the end of the century. But if you look at what's happened so far, just in the last few decades, it's 1 degree. So now you ask the question, 1 degree, how important can that be? Well, the answer is it can be very important. Let me give you an example, right? So there is this bacterium called Vibrio parahemolyticus, a big nasty name, but it causes a pretty serious intestinal illness, and you get it from eating shellfish, right? Now, we see it in New Orleans. We see it other places, warm places where you have shellfish. Never, ever, ever saw this in Alaska. And if you look
because
at Alaska,
it was too cold.
It was too cold. The water temperature was 13.8 degrees, 14.8 degrees. And this organism all of a sudden can begin growing high enough levels when you hit 15 degrees. So when you looked at the water temperature in Alaska and as it increases, when it went from around 14 degrees to just over 15 degrees, all of a sudden, an outbreak of Vibrio parahemolyticus, and since then, in the warmer waters, it's a major problem in Alaska.
There's also more some evidence about the temperature rising and mosquitoes migrating northward.
That's right. So mosquitoes, both the development of mosquitoes and the development of pathogens that live inside of them, like the malaria pathogen, they're both dependent very strictly on temperature. So when you move from the tropics up north, typically the temperature is cooler. But as the temperature in the north warms, especially in the winter, it allows these mosquitoes and their vectors to begin moving northward. And we're beginning to see a lot more diseases like malaria moving to higher elevations in the mountains and to higher latitudes.
Now, you're participating in the Center of Ethics Forum honoring the 50th anniversary of Silent Spring and the sort of forefront of the environmental movement, the modern environmental movement here in the United States. I want to show some video of what that looked like, because back in the day, it was talking about this book. It was rather instrumental in the ban of the insecticide or pesticide DDT because of its effects on birds and the environment. But what's interesting about this is it had a downside. The book helped to create the ban, but then there was a backlash, so to speak, or a downside to it. What happened after the ban took effect?
Well, so the ban took effect because there were birds dying and animals dying associated with the use of this insecticide, right? But the problem is that some of those insects that were dying were, in fact, harmful pathogens. Malaria is a great example of this, right? And so when you quit using DDT, it allows those mosquitoes to increase. And so there are more people who die due to infections with those diseases.
Could there be a similar backlash if we try to preempt this evolutionary response of insects, let's say, to this global warming or these pathogens? Could there be some unexpected backlash, like more resistance or more virulent strains?
And whenever you mess with nature, you don't know for sure what the exact impact will be. But one of the things that we have now that we didn't have when Rachel Carson wrote Silent Spring is we have a lot better ways of manipulating organisms. So, for example, a very big trial in the world now has to do with the mosquito that transmits dengue virus. And so people are releasing these mosquitoes that cannot divide, right? They can't populate.
Let me move on, because I do want to get to this. Climate change, it's part of the Center for Ethics. How is this a moral or ethical issue?
We're causing a lot of damage to our environment right now. A few countries, a lot of other parts of the world are suffering the damage that we're causing, and future generations will suffer that damage too.
who have no say in it, as you mentioned before. Stanley Maloy, thank you so much for your insight. And people can hear more about what you have to say about this on our website, kpbs.org. Thanks.
Thank you very much.